empathy that was shown to me as a child, or may not, or to me as a child who may or may not have been struggling, who may or may not have had a horrible situation at home, who just may have woken up on the wrong side of the bed. So I give grace to all my students. Black teachers are caring. I try to have a better understanding of their home life, if they're willing to share, to see how that's affecting what I'm seeing in the classroom. I try to have an understanding of their cultural background. Black teachers are spiritual. So I try to make sure I pray every day before I come in, because some days are harder than others. Just waking up black and a woman is hard. Black teachers are culturally sensitive. I have to be able to still be culturally sound amongst them. I have to be sensitive to what they say and how they feel about certain things. When I go around other counterparts, I have to do the same thing and vice versa. Black teachers are inclusive. With my students who speak Spanish, I love when my non-Spanish speaking students will be like, how do you say that again? When they hear them speaking Spanish to each other, then we'll try it. Or like, for instance, if I'm talking about vocabulary, one of my students loves to say the Spanish alternative to whatever I say while I'm reading. And so I just love that it gives them that extra piece of academics that I wouldn't have even think to include. They think, they kind of learn from each other. And so in bringing everything to a close, when we look at Black teachers' identity development, what we see is that their identity is in direct opposition to conservative value systems, which have been used to structure the Individual Freedoms Act. Implications for school leaders. And so for school leaders, a lot of our teachers discuss how, depending on the school and the situation, some teachers express extreme fear, whereas others, it was just, it's another day, another policy. And one thing that I noticed is it all falls back on the school leadership. If you have an educator that's going to support you in whatever aspect they need to support you, whether that's providing you with professional development or just, let me come into class, let me see what you have, do we need to rearrange some things around? And so implications for school leaders. School leaders need to cultivate a positive working environment. They need to ensure that teachers are well informed of the policy. They need to involve teachers in school level decision-making process. While we may not have the ability to change state level policies, but we can at the school level and how it is implemented. School leaders need to promote peer learning communities, as well as encourage public recognition of teachers' accomplishment and to support teachers' pedagogical decisions and teaching philosophies. Implications for policy and research. For policies, educators as well as educational researchers can use the finding of this study and any other study that relates to this topic to advocate on behalf of Black teachers and to demand that policymakers utilize that policymakers analyze anti-CRT policies and exclusionary practices to determine the ways in which they contribute to further marginalization of people of color. For future research, there are several ways in which I think this research can take form. For one, this research only focused in the North Florida region, but I believe we can expand the scope of this research to include other regions throughout the state of Florida. Also, I believe including non-Black teachers into this study would also do us some well. One teacher discussed a heartfelt conversation that they had with another instructor, which was a white teacher, who talked about just some of the angst that they felt because they wanted to incorporate the book A Raisin in the Sun, and the teacher wasn't even sure if they would even be able to, or if somebody would take what they said out of context. And so this research isn't just, or this particular policy doesn't just impact Black teachers. While that was my focus, there is room to also study how it impacts other teachers. I believe there's room for a longitudinal study to include the current individuals in this study as well as other identified groups to see ways in which this policy is going to impact the field of education. Now opening up to questions.
mute yourself there. I'll let this then become the one that we talk through.
Okay.
Later, just ran your sound off too.
Sure. I was just pulling up my notes again. Lovely, very, very, you know, clear and passionate and well organized presentation, as well as your writing. One of the things that I was reflecting on, but I can't see my notes, but I can remember, was the way that you organize your discussion of your results. I think that it was a little bit clearer, or you gave us a little bit more handholding in the presentation, and that you were speaking to a mixed crowd, explaining to us, you know, how you made these decisions around the counter stories and the composite counter stories. It could be helpful to do a little bit more of that guideposting for us in the results section of the writing. My ask was going to be if you could talk us through a little bit how you made those decisions about how to present your results. Because there are different ways that people put together the story of the results sometimes. Sometimes they organize it around their research questions. Sometimes they organize it around their theoretical framework. So I thought it was interesting the way that you set it up around the counter stories. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit how you came to that decision.
Mm-hmm. And so throughout this entire process, I reflected a lot about my teaching experience. Within the counter stories, the first counter story is presented as, you know, beginning of the school year, everyone's talking about all of the changes. And so when I thought back, I remember how with a lot of my close teacher friends, we would have these conversations. It starts off in the cafeteria with everyone, right? It's a more general conversation, and then it eventually tapers off to a more secluded conversation. And so when I designed my composite story, I was looking at how this would look for me if I was in this setting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you. That was really the main hook around what I wanted to hear from. I know that we got a late start and we'll be through on time. I have a couple other small things that I can share with you. Oftentimes when we're at the presentation stage, it's a little bit clearer, the more refined kind of high level thinking. So I have just some small notes around how to help, especially in this contested area, how to really like tightly anchor some of what you're sharing in the back end. I have a wondering note that other people may ask about in some version too, around what this was like for you to finish up the study during this time that was even more contested than when you began, mm-hmm. to see how things were maybe shifting over time or how that shaped some of your decisions as well as some of those discussions. But that may be a really long discussion, so I might just save that for later, but that was a note that I had anyway.
And I can just share just a little bit. I will say at one point I had gotten really scared. And I remember calling my friends crying, like, I don't think I'm gonna do this research, just because of what I saw was happening. And even one of the districts that I reached out to declined my IRB because, again, they didn't want, you know, to be a part of whatever might come from it, even though, you know, I assured that particular district that I'm not including your name. There will not be any identifiable, like if you notice in my research, I didn't include any information about student populations, just to make sure it cannot go back to that particular district. But nonetheless, the districts are afraid funding might be an issue. And so at one point I was very scared. I don't know, I didn't know if I was going to be able to do this research. And then on the other end of it too, it was sad to be able to know that teachers will, you know, this is what I'm experiencing as a researcher, and I have a little bit more leverage because I can always say, well, I'm a student, right, doing this work. But just in thinking about other teachers, especially teachers that I was privileged enough to talk to, who can't have these conversations. They can't sit in a school board and say what they want to say. They can't speak out loud in their schools because no one knows who's going to pull out a camera. And so it's a very scary topic to delve into, but I believe in this particular topic, because if it's not, if we don't share it, if we don't share their stories, it's going to just continue to be, you know, just another day in the ivory tower creating policies for the teachers to be able to implement.
Thank you. That was very helpful. And really kudos to you and the committee and your participants for doing all of this work during this time that involved, you know, risk and emotional labor as well as the labor of you know, crafting these stories.
I thought you did a really nice job using the language of the teachers perceive things as fair, though, because I mean, people can say, oh, that's not what the law actually did. But that's what it made people feel.
Right. Yeah.
Right? Rather, like, no one can deny that. Like, these folks felt this way about it. Yeah. So I think you avoid that criticism in this, because I think that's easily what folks say, well, that's really not what this did, right? Like, this actually did this. But it doesn't matter. It made people feel a certain way.
Right.
Did anyone talk to you about leaving teaching?
Yes. I had one in particular that said, this is going to be my last year. Mm-hmm. I cannot do this anymore.
Now, were they the older person?
Actually, no, the younger person.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yep.
I was curious if that came up. Is it in your stomach? I can't remember. Is it in the manuscript? It was not. I think it should be.
Yeah. Okay.
Because
yes.
I think that's a fear that you know a lot of administrators have too.
Right.
What is this going to do to, you know, am I going to have teachers in the fall?
Right.
Right?
Yeah. Right. Now, I will say a lot of the teachers also talked about, we have this teacher shortage. Why are we even pushing a policy such as this? And so, yes, I will definitely add it in if it's not.
Eric, do you want to go next? Eric, do you want to go next with the questions? I think he can hear me, right?
Yeah.
Oh, we have to unmute him because we have that on. Yeah, actually, I don't know how to do it, so if you know, that would be great.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Sheila, first, thank you for doing this this research study. As I read it and listened to your presentation, I just kept thinking, courageous, daring, having the audacity to give voice to folks who feel voiceless around this topic. I just had two questions around practice and policy. My first question was, what do you think are the ways that teachers can still culturally affirm their students, given that blackness, being black, is a part of their teacher identity? I mean, your identity really never goes away, and given this policy or this law that's in place, well, how do you think teachers can get around that and still be able to be authentic, especially with their black students and other minoritized students in the classroom?
Well, one of the ways I think teachers can continue to do what they're doing by lining their classrooms with posters of individuals that they feel as though represent their student population. One thing about culturally responsive pedagogy and affirming pedagogy is that it is inclusive. So, one teacher talked about how in their classroom library they have books on Hanukkah and Kwanzaa and MLK, or just different individuals. And so this teacher wanted to not just affirm the black students in their class, but all of their students. And so I think so long as teachers are continuously in being inclusive, then they should be able to still affirm students. But then, you know, the question is, will that be questioned, right? Because there were teachers who talked about having to remove certain items out of their classrooms, in particular certain books. And so there are ways that teachers can go around it. I would say the least contentious way would be to just provide everything, right? But it all depends on the views of their school leaders as well as their districts. And then the second question, I think I missed it.
Okay, I keep getting muted. That's No, I wanted to add, I appreciate your responses. I think the other thing, and if you can emphasize and highlight it some more, you talked about it in one of your slides, black teachers being empathic, black teachers, and I'll say that being relational. I think those are one of the things that we can continue to highlight. Having high expectations of our students, being encouraging and also affirming their needs, and even, I believe, in affirming that culture without even necessarily saying the words. I think about this law all the time because I train students to be school counselors. But one of the things that I continue to tell them is that you can still do the same work without necessarily using the language. You're doing it every day. Terms just haven't changed. You can still, you say underrepresented communities, you're still talking about Black, Latinx students, migrant populations. And so I think for implications around policy, how do we continue to train teachers to think a different way? We don't have to use the language, but we can still do it through actions and use other terms that are probably more friendly to the policies and laws that are being passed. And so my second question is, what are some of the strategies in which teachers can use to still address issues, and I would even say administrators, such as opportunity gaps, some of the biases that come in to treating students? One of the things I keep thinking about with this law being passed is how are we going to address the inequity and suspension rates of Black students? I mean, if you still look at the data, nothing changes, right? We just can't talk about it. Number two, how do we still address the issues when we talk about gaps and underrepresentation? We can say Black students, Latinx students, students who are potential first-generation college students may underrepresent in advanced placement courses, international baccalaureate programs, or gifted and talented programs. What are your thoughts around that?
I think for one, teachers can, it all goes back to the identity, the role identity that teachers occupy. I think if teachers are still occupying, because they're all still informal, right? And so I can occupy the role of being a caring teacher, and I don't have to include that in any of my lesson plans. I can occupy the role of being a protector and not even have to address that formally. And so I think teachers can still occupy these multiple roles, but I also believe that teachers need to advocate. While there are all these restrictions that surround what teachers can and can't do, can and can't say, teachers still have a voice, right? If you are, depending on the degree of their union and their level of influence, there is room to contact your union and see, okay, if I am discussing this topic, this complex, controversial topic, what can I do? What are ways in which I can ways in which I can curtail, I guess, what's being said so that it's not being taken out of context. So reaching out to union, there's lots of union that are actually putting out guidances in this area, but also I think it's incumbent upon our HBCUs who are servicing Black teachers. I think if they are providing teachers with the tools that they need at that level, teachers can then go into the classroom and better serve students. And then when we look at professional development, what are the professional developments that are being provided and offered to teachers? And so I think in some of those areas, teachers can find a way to work around the system. I don't think there's a one size fits all, because every school has a different context and will have different constraints. And so I think if teachers look at those three main areas, then they'll be in a better situation to support their students.
Yeah, muted again. Oh, yeah. Okay. Did you have anything else you
want to
add?
Yes, I just had one more quick question. So I think you did a really wonderful job of sort of walking, especially in your part, walking us through policies. And one thing, a thread that I noticed there that feels consistent both then and now is sort of this thread of articulating or arguing these things in the stead of or in the sake of parents, right? And parents' rights and articulation of that. Say, and some of its function around community and stuff like that. So I was curious, in your study or in your talk with the teachers, did anyone talk about how they have been approaching or navigating or thinking about this thing with parents and communities? And how, I'm just curious, like, did any of that come up?
Yes. So depending on the district, there was one district or one school in particular where, you know, teachers mentioned this isn't an issue, right? Because majority of the students here are Black or brown, and our parents don't even care about it or may not even know, you know, to the extent of this policy. And so for some teachers, them having the conversation with parents upfront kind of clear the air. In another school with another individual, one teacher talked about how, you know, this policy, especially this part of this policy, and I'm going to go on a little bit of a tangent, that don't say gay bill, right? And so we have teachers who talk about how we have parents who have two moms and two dads and whatever the case may be. You cannot discredit them from the conversation as well. And so when teachers are having conversations with parents, parents are like, you're good, do what you need to do. Teach my kids, because I can't do it. And so that is one of the common themes that I see amongst those teachers. Now we have other teachers who are like, look, I know my school, and I know the parents in which I serve, and so I am very conscious with what I say or how I present certain information because it may not come across in the way in which it should come across. So some teachers are not even having those conversations with their parents, and others are comfortable enough to have those conversations.
Well, that's really interesting, and I think that's something that could be incorporated somewhere in sort of that implication section, that you know, the idea that this is for parents is sort of antithetical if parents themselves or parents who teachers are speaking to don't see this as an issue. Then, you know, for a recommendation for policymakers or researchers, it can be, well, let's look into parents' perceptions of this and really start, you know, given on how teachers are navigating this and going around this, then is there really a parent element, and how do we use that to kind of counteract what's been going on? So, but yeah, wonderful work.
It makes me think about principals also, and like the, right, because we're here talking about unions, and unions are also under risk, but parents are potentially talking with the principals, and the teachers will ideally have a principal that supports them that they can go to for questions, but I don't know to what degree principals have the same kinds of networks to talk with themselves or to feel like they're getting protected, like they just need to be getting squeezed in the same way that, you know, department chairs and other leaders often are in this kind of middle position.
Right.
And so that may be something to think about in terms of the implications for practices, what kinds of supports there might be for helping those principals be better positioned to retain teachers and to help them teach what students need to know.
Do you have any questions for us, Sheila? No. So why don't we do this? We'll have you and everybody else step out just for a little while for our home audience. The committee is going to meet. We're going to move Eric into a breakout room. Stay here, and we'll be back in just a few minutes.